Servos are great. They are small, cheap, quite powerful, and very easy to use. You can find them in RC cars, boats, planes, and even in some drones. They are also widely used in robotics, from simple robot arms to advanced spider robots. But how exactly do they work? Well, let's take a look inside. So, when we remove the bottom cover, we can see that inside there is a small DC motor connected to a tiny PCB. Usually in servos you will find brushed motors, however some more expensive models take advantage of brushless motors, which for example have longer lifespan. On the top side we have some spur gears, that together work like a gearbox to increase the motor torque. Also, every servo needs some kind of control circuit that controls motor rotation based on received commands and data from the feedback sensor, which in this case is simple rotary potentiometer. Based on potentiometer resistance change, control board knows the exact output arm position, and that's why we can control servos so easily. But the thing I always liked about servos is how they manage to get so much torque out of those tiny motors. And one day I thought, well, let's try to replace them with something bigger to get even more torque. And the most powerful motor I had was this 3000 watts brushless outrunner that was used in my electric mountain board. But can we make a servo out of it? Well, let's find out. Alright, so if we want to make a big servo, first we need to create a design. That is why we are now in Fusion 360, and as you can see, there is a 3D model of our motor. I have also already designed all the other parts. So now, let me just show you a quick assembly animation, and later I will explain some of my design choices. Okay, so what you just saw was basically a gearbox with 81:1 reduction ratio. What you might notice is that the gears look a little bit different from the ones that we saw on the real servo. Well, there is a reason for that. You see, spur gears are very popular because they are efficient, cheap and easy to manufacture. However, they have plenty of downsides as well. They produce a lot of vibrations at high speeds and their teeth can't carry heavy loads. They are also known for being noisy and not operating very smoothly. That's why in heavy machines and vehicles you are most likely to encounter helical gears. Their teeth are set on an angle to the gear axis, which is highly beneficial. Since the teeth engage more gradually, they operate smoothly, can be used for heavy loads, and they are also quiet. But all of that comes with a cost, because this type of gear is harder to manufacture and also it produces an actual thrust force, which must be compensated by using special bearings. That leads us to the third type of gear, which is the herringbone gear. Herringbone gears are great, because they are basically two opposite helical gears stuck together in such a way that they do not produce actual thrust. They are so good that when André Citroën saw them for the first time during his trip to Poland in 1900, he immediately bought a patent and started his own production. When he began manufacturing cars 19 years later, he chose herringbone gears, which has led to his success as a logo for his company, that today we know as Citroën. However, in all their greatness, herringbone gears are very difficult to make with traditional methods, and that's why we don't see them that often. Luckily, I am using a 3D printer which can easily make any type of gear, so obviously I chose the best one. Another thing I should explain is the placement of a feedback sensor. What I am planning to do is simply add a rotary potentiometer with a gear right next to the output shaft, and hopefully this will allow us to convert it from just a gearbox to a fully functional servo. So now, when we have our design, it's time to print all the parts and put them together. After the assembly process, I decided to add some additional long screws to make the whole case more rigid. Now let's connect the motor wires to the VSC and let's see if this thing will work. Okay, so after this first run I realized two things. One is that this gearbox is very powerful and I need to make a robust mount to keep it in one place during further testing. The second thing is that I have to change the VSC settings, because I forgot that it's still programmed to work with my mountain board. So I plugged the USB cable in and opened the VSC tool. The only thing I had to change is control mode from current no reverse to pit speed control. And if you don't know anything about those modes, here you have a short explanation. Next I made a very professional mount from two pieces of wood, metal brackets and some screws. It might not look good, but it should get the job done. Let's see how it will work now. Well, you just saw that it works perfectly well and the speed is so much easier to control, which means that we are ready for the torque test. That's great, this gearbox can easily achieve about 15 Nm of torque, and I think that it still would be able to lift twice as much. However, this video was supposed to be about servo, so let's convert this gearbox into one before we break some gears with heavier loads. Right, so to make a servo we of course need to add a feedback sensor, and in my case it's one of these very popular rotary potentiometers. But before we can use it, we need to know if it shows correct values, which can be easily checked with this Arduino code. If everything is alright, we can proceed to the next step. We also need to check if we can read RC receiver data with our Arduino. Again, by uploading this code, we should be able to see correct values. Last thing we need to do is to test if we can control the VSC with an Arduino. VSC is basically just more advanced ESC, so it can also be controlled with PWM signal. Here I am using a potentiometer to control the motor speed, and it seems to work pretty well. So now when we checked all the components, we can write the final servo code. But to be honest, I am not very good at programming, so I took the code from this amazing James Bruton video as a base for my sketch. The next thing I had to do is to modify his code to work with the VSC instead of the DC motor driver that was used in the video. So what I did is basically I merged his code with the previous one that we used to control the VSC. And hopefully it might work. Finally, I installed the potentiometer. Keep in mind that at this point it should be set perfectly in the middle. And now, the moment of truth. Thank you. Well, surprisingly, it turned out to work pretty well. And after some time, I figured out that this configuration of P works best if there is a load on the servo. So I think that I can call this project a success, and I hope that it will help you to make your own servo, because now you can make it with basically any brushless motor that you have. But for now, thank you very much for watching, and if you enjoyed, you can leave a like or even subscribe, because now when the holidays just started, I am planning on making many more videos, so make sure you won't miss any. Thanks again, and see ya!